Mission Church. My name is Nick Hester, pastor here at the church. Good morning, everyone sitting in our pews. Good morning, everyone who's watching us online. Just got a couple of announcements for today. One, first off, Heinous Hands will be meeting this Saturday at 9 a.m. downstairs. And so if you got any questions, seek Elaine on that. Also got some information on the back of the bulletin. Always read that for information. Also, just a reminder also on August 21st at 10:30 a.m. is when we're going to be having our service with Saving Grace Lutheran Church. It's going to be over at Phoenix Park. And we are...
It's cutting in and out.
Just one. We'll work with it. Techno demons, they're the worst. Anyways, August 21st, our outdoor worship with Saving Grace Lutheran Church. Service is at 10:30. Lunch will be afterwards, supplied by the grilling guys at the Saving Grace. So be sure and bring lawn chairs to that, and that will be at Phoenix Park. All right, let's go to a time of worship here. Our opening hymn is Listen. God is calling. We're going to be working out of the blue hymnal today. Number 712. Please rise as you are able.
So that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all of our sins. As a called and ordained minister of Lutheran congregations and mission for Christ, and by God's authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all of your sins in the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Please be seated. Is really important in life. Now, this passage from Luke's gospel forces us to make a decision about what kind of life we want. Do we want a life dependent on the things of the world, or a life close to God that is dependent upon Him rather than the wealth of this world? Now, these verses are very relevant to us today because most people in America, for them, the main priority in life is to attain enough money to live the good life. And all too often, the mantra for obtaining happiness echoes that famous quote from Malcolm Forbes, "The one who dies with the most toys wins." I mean, we're bombarded on the media and television with shows like Lives of the Rich and Famous or Fabulously Wealthy Vacation Homes, and so on and so on. Today, no matter what you have, it seems like someone else always seems to have something bigger and better. So in chapter 12 of Luke's Gospel, Jesus is in the middle of a sermon teaching his disciples about their need to have a reverence toward God alone. And all of a sudden, in verse 13, Jesus is interrupted right in the middle of a sermon by a man who is dissatisfied over what he considers to be an unfair division of his father's estate between himself and his brother. Now, actually, I find it actually rather comforting that even Jesus could not keep everyone's attention when he was preaching. Now, this particular man in our gospel text really didn't ask Jesus for a decision on what would be a fair division of the estate. He just demanded, "Tell my brother to divide our father's estate with me." And as he usually does, Jesus did not answer as expected. And so he says in verse 14, "Friend, who made me a judge over you to decide things as that?" Now, Jesus refuses to be sidetracked from his mission of seeking and saving the lost. Instead, Jesus does not make a legal judgment, but makes a moral judgment instead. Jesus knew that this family feud over an inheritance was only a symptom of a greater problem of greed. In fact, the word "you" in verse 14 is actually plural in the Greek language. So that indicates that Jesus was saying both brothers have a problem with greed. And as long as both brothers are suffering from greed, Jesus knew that no settlement would end up being satisfactory to either of them. Yet, how often have we gone to God asking Him to change our situation rather than having Him change our hearts? All too often we pray for God to solve the problem in our lives rather than to pray to solve the problem that's within us. And that's why so many times we read about different life situations that are happening in the Bible, only to find out that those verses are also telling us about our own life situations today as well. That's what's a wonderful thing about the Bible. So Jesus now turns his attention to the whole crowd in verse 15 and says, "Beware, guard against every kind of greed." Jesus is saying to watch out and be on guard against the sin of greed. Now, the Greek word used here for the word greed is the word pleonexia, which means this: to have a desire. No, that's not it. Let me backtrack. It means wanting more of what you already have enough of. Wanting more of what you already have enough of. The book of Ecclesiastes says this in chapter 5, verse 10. Those who love money will never have enough. How meaningless to think that wealth brings true happiness. Yet, how often do we think and feel the same way? How many people think that if they could just win the lottery, then they could live the good life? So let's take a look at what Jesus says living the good life really means. Jesus says this in the last part of verse 15. Life is not measured by how much you own. Once again, Jesus turns how this world thinks completely upside down. And that's because the world then, and still does today, tell us that our quality of life does consist and depend on what we own. So Jesus then tells a parable. And this parable gives us five consequences of what happens when our hearts are focused exclusively on ourselves. The first consequence is that when our hearts are focused on ourselves, God doesn't get the credit. Verse 16 says this. Then he told them a story. A rich man and had a fertile farm that produced fine crops. Now, it's important to note that the parable does not condemn this man for being rich. And to his credit, it would appear that this man had come by his wealth honestly. However, as this farmer looked at his amazing harvest, he did not see the hand of God as part of that abundance. The farmer saw only his own effort. And so the farmer is a perfect example of greed because he has much, yet he wants and expects more. First consequence. The second consequence when our hearts are focused on ourselves is that we leave God out of our plans. Verses 17 through 18 tell us this. He said to himself, "What should I do? I don't have room for all my crops." Then he said, "I know. I'll tear down my barns and build bigger ones. Then I'll have room enough to store all my wheat and other goods." There's nothing wrong with the farmer's desire to build more barns. It was both wise and prudent. The problem was in the fact that there's no thought of sharing his abundance with others. Notice how the farmer says, "My crops, my barns, and my goods." He's confused between ownership and stewardship. The truth is that it's not his to own, rather it's his on loan. God has blessed the farmer with abundant crops. Yet the farmer doesn't share his wealth and does not even give God the credit for the abundance given to him. This then follows with a third consequence when our hearts are focused on ourselves, and that is we spend only on ourselves. Verse 19 tells us this. The farmer says, "And I'll sit back and say to myself, 'Ah, my friend, you have enough stored away for years to come. Now take it easy, eat, drink, and be merry.'" This man thought that when he put his plan into action, that he would be living the good life for years to come. However, all of this conjecture was based upon the supposition that this man expected to control not only the fate of his future crops, also the fate of himself. The farmer envisioned the future as continually expanding
and under his control.
However, nothing could be further from the truth. The book of James speaks to us of just such an attitude. It says this in chapter 4, verses 13 through 16. Look here, you who say, today or tomorrow we are going to a certain town and will stay there a year. We will do business there and make a profit. How do you know what your life will be like tomorrow? Your life is like the morning fog. It's here a little while, then it's gone. What you ought to say is, if the Lord wants to, we will live and do this or that. Otherwise, you are boasting about your own plans, and all such boasting is evil. Folks, the Bible doesn't discourage us from looking to the future with great expectation. However, as we make our plans, whether in business, our relationships, or in our personal lives, we are to do so from the perspective that ultimately God is in charge. In other words, we need to plan our lives with a humble reference for God's will in those plans. This brings us to the fourth consequence when our hearts are focused exclusively upon ourselves, and that is, we store our treasures in the wrong places. Verse 20 says this, but God said to him, you fool, you will die this very night. Then who will get everything you worked for? This man is pronounced a fool by God. Now the Greek word used here for the word fool is the word aphron, which has a meaning of lacking an internal perspective. Now, whenever you see the word fool in the Bible, it's not in reference to a mental ability, but rather to a spiritual discernment or lack of spiritual discernment. According to Scripture, a fool is a man who leaves God out of any consideration. Psalm 14, verse 1, says it like this. Only fools say in their hearts, there is no God. This man is a fool, not because he actually said this, but rather because he lived his life as if God doesn't exist. This farmer is a fool in that he didn't recognize that his material blessings came from God, nor did he recognize any obligation to God in the use of these possessions. Fools leave God out of their lives. And people who are greedy are also reflect the definition of a fool according to Scripture. Because when a person's heart is filled with greed, there's no room for God. Oftentimes, these same people feel that there is no life after death also. They grab what they can, while they can, however they can, and hold on to it tight. Leo Tolstoy once wrote a story about a successful peasant farmer who was not satisfied with what he already had. Leo Tolstoy wrote this story. One day this farmer received an amazing offer. For 1,000 rubles, he could buy all the land that he could walk around in a day. The only catch in the deal was that he had to be back at his starting point by sundown. Early the next morning, he started out walking at a fast pace. By midday, he was already tired, but he kept going, covering more and more ground. Well into the afternoon, he realized that his His greed had taken him far from the starting point, so he quickened his pace even more. And as the sun began to sink low in the sky, he began to run, knowing that if he did not make it back by sundown, the opportunity to even be a bigger landholder would be lost. As the sun began to sink below the horizon, he came within sight of the finish line. Gasping for breath, his heart pounding, he called upon every bit of strength left in his body and staggered across the line just before the sun disappeared. Unfortunately, he immediately collapsed, and in a few minutes, he was dead. Afterwards, his servants dug a grave, not much over 6 feet long and 3 feet wide. The title of Tolstoy's story was, How Much Land Does a Man Need? In this case, he all he needed was 6 feet by 3 feet. The Bible tells us that to be a fool is to have missed the point in life. The problem in this world is that a person who God calls a fool today is often called a success. However, God says in verse 20, you fool, you will die this very night. Then who will get everything you worked for? Since you can't take it with you, there really is no reason to wear yourself out by accumulating it. Everything you have will one day be left behind. The reality is, when was the last time you saw a hearse pulling a trailer? This then leads to the fifth consequence when our hearts are focused on ourselves, and that is, we are in conflict with God's plan for our lives. Verse 21 says this, yes, a person is a fool to store up earthly wealth, but not have a rich relationship with God. The riches of this world have one major weakness. They have no purchasing power after death. So, to have a rich relationship with God, we need to use what God has given us for His glory and for others. And we began this study by noting that the daily word pulled in a bunch of different directions, and we're left wondering, what is really important in life? And the answer to this question is in verse 21. So what is really important in life is actually another question which we need to ask ourselves. Are we going to live life and just be rich for ourselves? Or are we going to share the abundance God has given us and instead be rich with God? Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for the abundance, the amazing abundance you have given us that has truly blessed this church and all of the people here. Lord God, give us guidance and discernment to how you want those blessings that you have bestowed us with to build your kingdom here in our community, our county, our country, and to the continents. And we pray this in the holy name of your Son, Jesus. Amen.
I'll fly away, no glory. Just a few more minutes and then I'll fly away to a land where George will never end. I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory. I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, I'm high. I'll fly away. And when I die, hallelujah, I'm high.
I know you won't find that one in any of the Lutheran hymnals, but you will find it in a blue hymnal, not the one we have, but Baptist hymnal. Hold on, that's a good one. Yeah. Broadening your ecclesiastical horizons here. Please rise as you were able for the Apostles' Creed. And let's all proclaim together the words of our Christian faith.
I believe God the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day He rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Lord God, we thank You for the abundance You have bestowed upon this church. I mean, it's amazing. It's amazing. The things we have been able to accomplish in this church, not only for the church itself, but for the 21% that goes for building Your kingdom here in this world, Lord. Thank You for that. And I thank You for this church that's walking in the precepts that You want for this church. Lord, help us to continue to walk in that. We've been here, been around for 6 years, Lord, and it's so easy to fall into that pattern of just moving along and doing the same thing, Lord, put it on our hearts. Keep us on fire, Lord, for the thing You want for this church to be, to light on a hill to this community, to this county, to this country, and to the continents. Lord, in Your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord God, we pray for this nation. We've turned away from You, Lord. And we've got an election coming up, Lord, and there's a lot of us scratching our heads, going, what are we going to do? Lord, bring forth a person that You want to lead this country. That's going to follow in Your will and not their own agenda. And then, Lord, put it on our hearts as we go to vote in November, Lord, who You want that person to be. Lord, we trust in them. We trust that You have got that person in mind, Lord, and so we'll be at peace with that, Lord. Help us as a nation, help us as a people to turn back to You. Lord, in Your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Father God, we pray for all those soldiers who are fighting for this nation, putting their lives on the line for us, Lord. Protect them, Lord God. Bring them home. Bring them home to their families, Lord, and then help us as a nation to stand by them as they stood by for us. Lord, in Your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we pray for all those soldiers fighting out on the streets of our community, all those law enforcement personnel that are there to serve and protect. All those fire department personnel, Lord, protect them, Father God. Wrap Your arms around them and help us, Lord, to stand by them. Help us, Lord, to help them any way possible and to support them. Lord, in Your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Father God, we pray for all those soldiers fighting in the front lines for Your gospel truth. All those missionaries that we support individually and as a congregation, Lord, protect them. Protect their health. Protect the health of their families. Protect them from any kind of human evil and evil of Satan. And Lord God, please provide them with the resources they need to do the ministries You've called them to. Lord, we pray especially for Judy Foster and especially Pastor Eddie and Charles as next week, and they go into a time of revival there down in Haiti, Lord. There are friends of mine who are doing an amazing ministry down there, Lord. Judy Foster with Orphanage, she's running, Pastor Edian with leading the Pentecostal pastors down there. Lord, they're having a big convention next weekend that we support as a church financially, Lord. And it's a huge outreach to the people out there for you. And Father God, we just ask you for the weather to be good. We ask you for safe travel for all those pastors who are going to the convention there in Lakai. And Father God, we just ask you to protect them from the evil one. Lord, all these prayers for those missionaries, both in our hearts. Lord, we just, and those who pray for every single night when we go to bed, Lord, we pray them. In the holy name of your Son, Jesus, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
If there's anyone who has any prayers that they'd like to make at this time, please go ahead and say them. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in the mercy of your Son, Jesus. Amen. May the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Please share the peace of God with one another.
Thank you. Lord.
Amen.
Being it's the last Sunday of the month, we're going to sing the Lord's Prayer at this time. Do I get the right words up? Yes, I do. Woo-hoo. Sweet. If I could have you please rise as you are able.
Thank you.
means to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.